But Richard, you got to admit, the optics of some of the things that they've chosen to expend energy on raise a lot of questions about how they're using their time and resources.
Sure, it does. But I think in this case of Elon Musk, it really does create a larger thing at play. Number one, I think what they're arguing here, let's be very clear for the audience. These aren't folks who have crossed the border illegally. These are folks who have come into this country. They're a refugee. They might be from Afghanistan. They might be from Ukraine. They filed for refugee status. They've been approved for refugee status. They are highly qualified in many cases. They're rocket scientists, rocket engineers. They want to work at SpaceX. And what Elon Musk and his executives are saying is you cannot apply for a job here because we only want to hire Americans, even though there might not be an American qualified for this position. But beyond that, what we also see happening in Elon Musk's world is that at Twitter, or formerly now called X, is there's also a lawsuit pending around racial and sexual discrimination based on the fact that he laid off more women than men. So it seems to be a pattern around Elon Musk that is quite problematic, given the fact that the U.S. government relies on him way too much for space travel as well as charging stations. So there's a lot happening here, Shannon, to say the least.
There is. And as a former labor and employment attorney who dealt with all these discrimination cases and all these kinds of things, they're very messy and they take a lot of time. And they're allegations until proven otherwise. And, you know, we'll see what a jury has to say on that. In the meantime, Tammy, if the GOP, if conservatives are going to be about rule of law, and there are potential legal violations here, why should Elon get a pass?
Well, the rule of law is key. I think what the optics here are very interesting when it comes to the timing with the argument that the federal government is picking and choosing. That, no, they're not looking at the Biden situation as an example. Donald Trump, though, has got, you know, 91 charges against him, indicted 4 times. And then a man, Elon Musk, who also challenges the status quo. Did not make a lot of friends on the left when he bought Twitter, which is now X. And so we see these kinds of targeting approaches from the federal government. And of course, the trust in the federal government at this point, especially the Department of Justice, continues to decline. So I mean, we obviously want everyone to be fair, but we also, when we think about the hiring of Americans, we're dealing with an economy that's difficult. And, you know, we're not entirely sure when we're looking at the issue of refugee status that, in fact, people do just come across the border and are saying, I'm a refugee, and then they're released. There's a reason why U.S. At least residency is required, because you've been vetted. This is an argument by the government that that dynamic isn't required. And when you've got 800,000 year-to-date right now coming across the border, you've got 591 people
Tammy,
on the terrorist watch list. Let me finish. I didn't interrupt you, Richard.
But you're mixing apples and oranges here. People crossing the border illegally and refugees are two different categories.
Come on, Richard.
To be fair.
Hold on.
Excuse me.
Tammy, finish your answer so we can move on to our next topic.
Thank you. That's the issue, is that what the government is viewing as someone who is a refugee in this country, with the terrorists that we've caught, the criminal aliens that 10,000 the Border Patrol has encountered, but it's only arrested 800. There is a security issue with the rockets and the nature of Elon is saying he can't even hire Canadians because of certain restrictions. So this does have to go to a court. A judge is going to have to determine what's going on. And considering the government's attitude and who they go after, I think they are going to have a few losses in this regard.
Yeah, and Tammy, I think some of the concerns you're bringing up are in the context of asylum, which I think is what Richard was trying to get to. So we'll go on to the next topic, because this is going to play out in court probably for years. Okay, it's definitely no secrets that President Biden's age has been a big concern as he campaigns for re-election. That keeps showing up in polling with Republicans, independents, Democrats alike. Well, former advisors now say the Democrats are downplaying their worry over his fitness to hold office and puts forth this possible theory.
They talk behind their hand. Nobody wants to get on TV and say it, because we all like to be able to go to barbecues and house parties, but people are concerned. I do think that anybody but Trump going up against someone like Biden, given some of his challenges recently, probably might have a good shot and could make that age an issue.
This is going to be a tricky one. Tammy, we'll start with you on this, because the polling does show across the board there is concern about this issue. But, you know, President Biden has embraced this. He's running. He's the incumbent. I mean, Democrats can't exactly say, like, no, Mr. President, we've decided you're not running.
Well, you know, it's interesting. They had their basement campaign because they felt, apparently, that it was too dangerous to have him even that many years ago in front. He himself said, to placate people's worries, that he would be a one-term president. So when you're looking at what there was an acknowledgement of to just get Trump out at the time, it was Joe Biden. And there was this presumption that, you know, he wouldn't continue. And then that means, of course, if, as Nikki Haley is asserting, that they know it's going to be, in fact, a handover to Kamala Harris, who could not win on her own, but allows the same group of people handling Joe Biden to continue handling the White House. And then they can, of course, claim the first woman president. I would prefer a woman president who knows what she's doing, will be competent, and that will help this country get back on her feet. And that is certainly not the vice president at this point.
Well, her numbers, as you know, Richard, are lower than the president when it comes to approval. And that, you know, even with the Democrats, they have real concerns about her. But what about the, you know, what will be part of these debates is that Republicans will say a vote for President Biden is potentially a vote for a President Harris.
Look, I'm not sure about the, you know, the house parties and the barbecues. I have my own at my house, so there's that.
Invite us.
Shannon, you're always invited. But look, I think there are some Democrats out there, and I think there are some folks who voted for the president in the last election that are indeed concerned about age, and they're indeed concerned that many of the things that the president promised when he ran the first time have not been delivered on. I think as we get into this campaign swing, what the president's going to have to do, because whether you are Donald Trump or whether you're former President Barack Obama, both of them would have loved to have the bipartisan wins that Joe Biden had. So now Joe Biden's going to have to go out and sell that to the American people, and that's going to be on him.
We got to leave it there because that is how this happens. You get out there and campaign. I will see you all at the barbecue, the house party, whatever it is this weekend. Thanks, guys. Thanks.
Hey, everyone. I'm Emily Campagno. Catch me and my co-hosts Harris Faulkner and Kaylee McEnany on Outnumbered.